All right. Hello, everybody. Welcome, welcome to another Fab Collab with Dolfan Dale. We are going to be doing a quick discussion on a couple new albums that not only we, but quite a large crowd of people have been desperately anxious to see reissued for I don't know how many decades. And so it is with great, great pleasure that we both received both the CD and vinyl, first time on vinyl remaster CD edition of the band Bride that just came out. And but before we get into these are the ones that we're really, really, really excited about. 91 and 92 are these releases. But real quickly, for those who may not be familiar with Bride, I wanted to just a real quick breakdown. In the mid-80s, they were Matrix. There has been a couple different releases of the old Matrix demos. This is one. It has a reissue that I believe, Dale, you said you already ordered, right? So,
yeah, it looks a little different. I think it might only cover a couple of years.
Yeah, this is not the complete. It just says on here that it's got 20 songs from two of their tapes. And then they got signed and changed the name to Bride, and we've got their 1986 Show No Mercy, which we are hoping we get it reissued on vinyl at some point. It was originally on vinyl, but hard to find. Live to Die, the 1988. Silence is Madness, 1989. This one has been reissued on CD and vinyl, but like last year, I believe. Beautiful, beautiful. Yeah. And then that brings us up to where we are. Now, they've continued on. We know that they had a brand new album out just last year, not even a year, months ago. Also on vinyl and CD for This Is Your God. And that's
great album.
Great album. And they've got this many other albums that I'm not going to talk about because... That brings us up to where we are, and from what I recall you saying, Mr. Dale, you said you discovered them around this time, which would have been the 1991. So take it away. Tell us a little bit about your experience with these.
Well, I guess at the time that I discovered Bride, I was just kind of fringely getting into Christian metal. Seemed to me that a buddy of mine, while I was still in Danville, he picked up Kinetic Faith and played, I think the first song he played for me was Everybody Knows Your Name, or Everybody Knows My Name. Which one is it? Everybody Knows My Name.
Right.
And killer song, got me hooked. And lots of great songs on that album. And so I listened to this a lot. And so by the time Snakes came out, it was kind of like a no-brainer. I was going to pick that up. And then that album blew me away.
Almost everybody tends to feel that way. And that's why this getting reissued is such a big milestone for those of us fans, because this was their first album on a major label. They switched from their earlier albums being on Pure Metal Records, which was, you know, major for the metal market, but it was, you know, still a smaller label. And then Star Song had a much bigger footprint when it comes to the record situation. So this was like their first major debut, and that made it a little harder, obviously, to get the rights to reissue it. But, you know, we have it now. That's not it. It's this one. We got them both now on vinyl. And these neither one of these, because these are the 90s, neither one of these were on vinyl originally. So, yes.
Right.
And, of course, people like Dale and I splurge and buy everything. So...
Well, you know, these were such great albums. Like I've told other people, as for my money, one, I think, Rattlesnakes is one of the great opening tracks of all time. And I'm not talking just Christian metal. I'm talking heavy metal. I mean, it, when you talk about opening tracks, it belongs in that discussion of great opening tracks. And then about three songs deep, it's as strong as about any metal album I've ever heard. And it's great all the way through, but I mean, those first three songs, Rattlesnake, Would You Die For Me, and Psychedelic Super Jesus. I mean, it's just nearly impossible to get an album started that strongly.
Yeah, and there's so many strong songs. Like you said, even throughout the rest of the album, there's, what do we got? We got like 14 tracks on here, and it is just a powerhouse. Those first three, really, it's just pow, pow, pow. I love Fallout, which is a fourth song. It is a little, it's more of a commercial feel to it, but yeah, and it's just, yeah, it's a very strong album. Obviously, most people think it's one of their strongest, and yes, it's just been it's been great that they've reissued it. Let's now you had mentioned coming into them around this time, real briefly. I did discover them when they were still Matrix. I ordered tapes in the mail, and so I had a couple of their original cassettes before they changed their name, and then when they came out as Bride, I picked up that first album. Gotta admit, the first album was a radical change from the Matrix days. If you go back and listen to them, Matrix was kind of just rock and roll, kind of quirky rock and roll, and Dale's vocals were kind of interesting. But when Show No Mercy came out, he kicked it up a notch. It was a whole different animal there with the way he sang and everything. And then the second album, it's kind of where I feel he fell into place. His vocal, because the first one and the second album, Matrix was really different. The first album was way different than that. Second album, I felt, was different than the first. But then from there on out, I feel like he really found his niche in the way he, in his vocal styles. And most people consider him to be, you know, if you want to start comparing it, people in the metal field are always looking for what they consider the high watermark of vocalists. And they'll throw out names like Ronnie James Dio or Jeff Tate. These are the guys that melodic this and power metal this, or, you know, or Rob Halford for that kind of metal. And I believe Dale ranks up there with the Dios and the people along that line. He is probably one of the most solid powerhouse vocalists. And this album is evidence of some of the best work that he and the band have done. Him and his brother, the band is made up of him and his brother, in case people who are watching don't know. So yeah, it's been great. And I've already given him a spin, and you know, they sound amazing on the vinyl now.
Yeah. So yeah. And this was a good group to put together too, because Kinetic Faith really was a good lean-in album. I mean, you could really, if you go back listening to it, knowing what we know now, Kinetic Faith was really kind of the launching pad into Snakes. I mean, you could really hear them coming into that.
Yeah, Bride is one of those bands that changes. Like I said, the first album was way different than the second. The second was like a solid metal borderline, kind of had some little thrash elements and some of the speed. The third album went a little more laid back, but yet still powerful. It was like a little change of pace. And then Kinetic Faith came out, and it was a little change of pace. At first, I was kind of not sure where I stood with that after it took a while to get used to Silence is Madness. And then when I started loving that, the Kinetic Fate thing came out, and I'm like, I don't know. But then you start loving that, and then all of a sudden you get hit between the eyes with Snakes.
Right.
The playground.
But don't you think that the musicality of Kinetic Fate kind of matches up well with...
Now that I listen to them, like...
Snakes.
Since I got them and listened to them back to back, they sound like a part A and a part B to a degree. They are natural progression. Right. Definitely they go together. You can see the flow of how the band has changed just a little bit here and there, and it just kind of grows right into it. And they continue to change over their career. Each album is a little different, but everybody keeps saying, we want Snakes Part 2. I do want to mention, you probably might be aware of this, but it's really odd timing. But the bass player on both of these albums, Rick Foley, he passed away today. And so that has got to be just weird timing, because these albums just hit most people's doorsteps like yesterday. And it was either today or yesterday, but I heard it was announced today all over online that he passed away. I believe it was cancer, but I'd have to look at their I would have to look at their catalog. I know he played on both of these, but I'm not sure. I haven't looked to see did he play on ones before or after. I don't think he was with the band, a super long amount of time, and I don't got my glasses to read the next album. But yeah, I heard about that earlier today. It struck me because I was loading this information on Discogs as new releases, and so I was putting his name in as a bass player. So when somebody mentioned his name, I'm like, oh my goodness, are you kidding me? I just typed his name in Discogs, last night. So. Well, let's show some of the actual releases here. So why don't you start with one? Give us a display of these new remastered, whether you want to do CD, vinyl, whatever you want to do.
Well, I guess we'll start with CDs.
Sure.
And of course, we got Kinetic Faith disc, and it looks good. Of course, first thing you notice coming right out is that card, Troy Thompson, on the Kinetic Faith card specifically.
Card number 22 in the series, yep.
And then I noticed I kind of like this. Back in the day when we first bought these, I know my OG copies there, they've got the black tray, whereas these are clear, so they've kind of spruce them out with some green in there for the Kinetic Faith album. And of course, anytime you have a, with these companies, Scott Waters probably worked on this, I'm sure.
Yeah. With the layout.
And, they always do a nice job with the booklets, giving you band pictures and lyrics. Good picture of Dale there. And Troy there. Yeah, so they always do a nice job with their booklets.
This is just so people can see this. This is the original you were talking about. It's got the regular black.
Yeah.
And here, this is how much better of a job these new ones are. This is the original booklet. Okay, booklet, no.
There you go.
Eligible. No way that you can read that without magnifying glass or glass. That's the book, is the lyrics, and in the back. So yeah, they have Girder Music has done us one up for sure. Major improvement. And I know Scott probably had some do with that, because he cannot stand lyrics that can't be read. And he's always making them things more.
Yeah, better. And he pretty much works on all of these, doesn't he?
The layout and design and stuff, yes.
Yeah, so... So that's a good CD. Good job on the CD for Kinetic Faith.
This is the I guess I'll show the vinyl for that one. I mean, it's not a whole drastic amount different. It's just bigger and prettier.
Yeah, but that's the beauty of LPs, though.
Yes,
they look so much. They look so beautiful when they're
there's Rick Foley, the bass player,
in that large format.
It is part of the limited run vinyl, so you have to not delay forget how many there were. I'm sure they had to have done more than just 100, but anyway, and it's got similar artwork there. It looks like it's signed, but you know, it's a reproduction of that.
The lyrics, is that a reproduction?
Yeah. The lyrics are nice and done. And then of course it's gotta be color coded. I got a clear sleeve in there.
And I like it when they take into consideration the colors of the actual project when they do the vinyl.
Right.
Sometimes it's a little off-putting to me when you make a random color that has nothing to do with the artwork. So, you know, for me, the green for the Kinetic Faith was just, yeah, that was the absolute right choice.
All right. Well, I'll jump into this CD for the next one, and you can show the vinyl for the Snakes in the Playground. It's I'll show that in a second. It's very much similar to the original. If you have the original, I've already broken my cover, so I'm gonna take that right off of there. I broke the hinge. Just like Kinetic Faith, you've got booklet nicely laid out, nice legible lyrics that you can read, similar to the pictures. But yeah, it's all a nice lyric book. The CD is very much the same, matching looking, and then the tray, you know, has the logo there. I'm trying to get this glare up here. And of course, it's got a snake pattern. When compared to the original, obviously the cover looks about the same, but we've again got just a black case with it's silver with a little bit of the snake brown covering the silver, and then the lyric sheet is just another, since it is a different label, it's a threefold, but look at that. Seriously? Go ahead, Dale. Read that out to us loud right now. Go ahead. I mean, this is probably cool, wow. You know, 30 years ago when we were kids and we bought these, but it's like,
yeah,
no thanks.
Yeah. But, we don't stay that young forever.
You show the card for that. Cause I put my, I have my cards in these little cases.
Okay. Did you show the long box?
Oh, okay. Well, I'll do that too. So yeah, this one did come in two versions. You've got the actual CD, which is what that was. And the CD has a card in it that Dale will show you. And then
there's the card.
And then it came in this long box edition, which we have confirmed. The CD in the long box is the same card as the CD out of the long box. But when you buy the long box, you get a second card, and it's a special card. It's not numbered. It's got a wonderful snakeskin texture to it. And it's got the logo there. So,
yeah, I thought this card was really cool.
That is definitely a collector's edition there, and only available in the long box. So if you buy the long box, you get both that one and the picture of Dale that he showed before. So you get two cards in the long box. Now, we bought the combo pack that came with the vinyl record, the long box, and the single CD. So technically, we have an extra CD, but that way you have both formats that you can keep, preserve, or whatever. And you get a duplicate card in that situation. So,
yeah. And then, of course, we have the LP edition, Snakes on the Playground.
Finally.
Man, finally. I never thought I would see it that large. I thought it was going to be a CD until the day I die.
Too bad they couldn't have went the extra mile and put the texture on there. That would have been wild.
Looks good on the back as well. I thought the group shot on the front of the center sleeve was a great one. And then, of course, we have lyrics on the other side. And this vinyl is...
I guess they call it a red-black swirl. To me, it's just kind of like a red-black marble, smoky marble type look.
Yeah, Yeah, that's sounds about right.
But it kind of makes it pop with the, if you look at the cover, you've got just a little hint of the red in there.
Yeah.
That matches, you know, you got the green for the other one, and it's just, they really, really, really went the extra mile to match up, give us a good match there.
Yeah, I think that was an excellent choice as well. It's an outstanding looking project.
And it sounds great. Sounds great. I listened to it yesterday. You know, it's been a couple of years. I don't know. You know, I go back to this album periodically. It's probably one of the ones I listen to the most, but, you know, it's been a while since I listened to it. So when I put it on yesterday on LP for the first time and I turned it up, I was just like, it was like going back in time. It was just such an amazing, every song, and I'm singing along. It's just weird how lyrics stick with you. And I'm just going, wow, this is such a great, solid album. Great stuff.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And thankfully, Gerter Music has done a great job in not just bringing us the two albums on vinyl, but doing it the right way.
The packaging, everything, the CDs, I mean, you know, remastered by Rob Caldwell, who always does an excellent job. And so, yeah, I mean, if you're even a nominal Bride fan, you need to jump on these, because this is some of the most coveted albums by them. And I really don't think, I'm surprised they've stayed around this long. They just got released and most everybody's getting them. I'm seeing people online showing them. I got mine yesterday. Dale got his yesterday. So they're hitting everybody's doorsteps now, but I'm surprised they didn't sell out pretty quick, but it's, I'm sure they're not going to last long. They are limited. Right. So
they are both great albums, but I tell you what, I can't wait to, I always clean mine first. And I can't wait to drop that needle on there and crank it to 11 for Snakes, because that will be an awesome moment.
I have to wait till everybody leaves my house. I can get up to 11. So, you know.
I hope, yeah, and I hope my neighbors enjoy Bride as much as I do.
Yeah. I like that meme I saw not too long ago. I think I shared it on my Facebook. It says, my neighbors are listening to some really good music, whether they want to or not.
Oh my. Yeah. Have you ever seen Bride live?
I have not, other than on video. I have never had a chance. I've always lived in places where they never are. Now, you know, so in case people don't know, you're basically a hometown boy for them. So have you ever seen them live?
No.
See this? And how do you expect me to do it when I'm like at the time?
Well, sometimes they'll play festivals that aren't around here. I mean, got was, Ichthus, and Ichthus would have some good bands, but not like Cornerstone.
I only got to make it to Cornerstone one time, and that was in 87, and that would have been a little early in their career. They only had the one album out. And so, no, I've never gotten to see them. A lot of the time in their heyday in the 80s and 90s, I lived in Mississippi, and not a whole lot of bands came down there. I was stationed down there in the military and then stuck around for a while. Started a church and stuff down there, and nothing there. And then we went to New York, which you would think would be a big town, but we lived in Long Island, and there's not a whole lot of, you know, not a whole lot going on out there. So,
right. Seems like at any time that they have the really good festivals there, either Cornerstone or farther out west. I think the West Coast gets them a lot better than we do.
Yeah. Well, all right. Well, and I guess we shouldn't ramble on too much. You got any last things you want to say? Any stories about Bride you want to relay? I mean, neither one of us has seen them live. I don't know. I've just enjoyed the music over the years, having been, you know, listening to them since album one. But, you know, any last stories you want to tell?
The only other really big memory I have was back when I was at Berea College, and a buddy of mine had DJed some dances, and I was known for playing Christian music. And so this guy he wanted to do this kind of open discussion, kind of taking the stigma out of religion. He offered me, he said, you play Christian stuff, I'll play other stuff about loosely about God and stuff, and we'll just have this mix. And I thought, All right. Well, I'll give it a shot. So I think he played like Personal Jesus, Depeche Mode.
Oh, yeah.
And then I countered with Psychedelic Super Jesus. And he was like, whoa, that's really awesome. And I never forget that particular song really connected with some folks that weren't into Christian metal, but they realized, hey, these guys got some stuff going on here.
Yeah, that is an amazing. It's got an amazing riff and groove to that song. So, again, if you're not familiar with this album, check it out. I'm sure it's online somewhere, but you know, and then make sure you buy it before it goes away.
Yeah. This is one going to be one of the matter of fact, I think if we did a list top 10 all time Christian metal albums, does this make it?
It would have to be high ranking up there.
It would definitely have to be in the discussion.
Oh yeah. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah,
I could definitely see it in my top 50, but I'm thinking even probably top 20. I just haven't stopped to think what are some of the other albums that would make it in there. Because every album makes a list for a different reason. And, you know, this or lyric this or this touched me or at this time in my life, you know. And so when I think of pivotal albums like this, you know, I would throw in so many other bands that are along the same line. So anyway, we can rant and rave about it all night. But the point is, Greg, Girder Music, they have just put out some fantastic products. Rob Caldwell did a great remastering job. Scott has, you know, helped make the record pop. I mean, the artwork and everything come to life for something that's never been on vinyl, that's, you know, now big and everything. And as a team, they have just done us a real solid one here with two of albums we never thought. Now the next album, also the Scarecrow Messiah, also on Star Song, slightly different style, probably not as popular, but in my book I hope that comes out too, because that Snakes and Scarecrow are in my life and my nostalgic life. Those two are albums that really had a lot, you know, had a big influence on my life. So I'd love to see those, and they are the only two that are on Star Song, which is the big label. So but to have one, to have the Snakes on from that little,
that was a big one.
That's a big
one. I can't think of another Christian metal album that wasn't already on vinyl that better than Snakes. To me, Snakes was at the top of that list of albums that had never been on vinyl that needed to be.
And that was, I think, that was the first one that wasn't, because their first three albums were originally on vinyl. And this one was the first one that went out of the vinyl record phase. So we've been wanting this for a long time. And here it is. And then, you know, of course, Kinetic Faith and all those all around that same. No, I'm sorry. Kinetic Faith was the first one that was. I keep wanting to put Snakes first. Kinetic Faith, I don't think, was on. That one never got released on vinyl, right? It was the first three only. Right.
I don't think Kinetic Faith.
Correct. That one wasn't. So the first three came out and they had vinyl releases, and Kinetic Faith was the first one that did not get one. So these are the first time these two are on, even though Silence is Madness, the third album, was reissued on vinyl, and rumor in the underground is that the first two are also forthcoming, but those had original releases, which I have some of. So yeah, big deal here. Big deal with these two releases.
Yes.
Buy them. Everybody buy them so they can see how great the vinyl records are, and they can put more of them up.
Oh yes.
So, all right. So I guess we will end it here then. And again, any last words from you? I think I've rambled on about as much as I can.
No, just glad that everybody that stopped in to listen to us ramble about Bride. Glad you're here. And until we see you again, peace.
Yeah, thanks for watching, and we'll be back. Who knows what the next collab may do? Maybe. When will it be? All right, thanks a lot for watching. See y'all later.